When the White Island eruption occurred in 2019, I remember thinking that I wished I could cover it on my YouTube channel. Since that is no longer a wish, and since new footage has been released, let's break down what happened during the White Island volcanic eruption. We'll discuss what unfolded before, during, and after it, with us focusing on the volcanic timeline and the events that took place. White Island has long been known as one of the most active stratovolcanoes on the planet, and it has a long history of fumarolic activity interspersed with phreatic, phreatomagmatic, and magmatic eruptions. Because of this long history, and despite real-time monitoring, identification and early warning of eruption precursors at this and similar volcanoes remains challenging. This was known long before the 2019 eruption. White Island is an andesitic stratovolcano at the northern end of New Zealand's Taupo volcanic zone. As a result, it's being fueled by the subduction event occurring beneath the waves. The Pacific Plate is subducting beneath the Indo-Australian tectonic plate. Here's a detailed rundown of the events that took place before, during, and after the 2019 eruption. Pre-eruption signs. In October 2019, volcanic tremors and sulfur dioxide gas were at their highest level since 2016, indicating that an eruption was more than likely to occur. On the 18th of November, the volcano was rated at a volcanic alert level 2, indicating moderate to heightened volcanic unrest due to increased activity. Formation of the hydrothermal seal. As the volcanic activity continued, a hydrothermal seal began to form within the volcano's hydrothermal system. Various processes, including mineral precipitation, hydrothermal alteration, pore blockage, and the formation of low permeability layers, created this seal. So essentially, a seal formed in a hydrothermal system, creating a jam that trapped the escape of gases and fluids escaping from the magma chamber, leading to rapid pressurization of the system. On the 9th of December in 2019, at around 2:11 p.m, the pressure within the hydrothermal system became too great, causing the seal to fail. This failure led to a sudden explosive release of the trapped gases and fluids, resulting in a phreatic eruption. The ash plume rose 3.7 kilometers or 12,000 feet into the air. There were 47 people on the island at the time of the eruption. This initial phreatic eruption, while dangerous in and of itself, was just a prelude to the real danger, that being the transition to a phreatomagmatic eruption. Following the initial phreatic eruption, the explosive fracturing of rock allowed water to come into direct contact with the magma chamber. This interaction between water and magma led to a phreatomagmatic eruption, which was observed as a change in the color of the gas cloud from white to black. In essence, this means that water and magma directly made contact with one another, causing the water to instantly flash to steam, creating unbelievably powerful and destructive explosions in the process. And you can see that it occurred right here in the footage that was taken of the event, when the noxious volcanic cloud turned from white to dark colored, indicating a change in the type of material being ejected during the eruption. I made a very in-depth two-part series a while ago, back when I had a terrible mic, but it is jam-packed full of info. The first part explains every magmatic volcanic eruption, and the second part covers every phreatomagmatic eruption, how they differ, the underlying mechanisms, and more, before touching on phreatic eruptions. You can find the link to both of those videos in the description. But yeah, in a phreatomagmatic eruption, magma comes into direct contact with water, leading to more explosive activity. The dark color of the plume is due to the higher content of ash, rock fragments, and other volcanic materials being ejected from the volcano. The ash and other fine particulates in the plume can absorb and scatter light, making the plume appear darker. So during the phreatomagmatic phase, the crew really began to be in danger. Volcanic blocks and bombs, along with pyroclastic flows, began to be released, and this is what caused much of the scorching witnessed in the survivors. Now, thankfully, this pyroclastic flow, as crazy as it seems, was rather, shall we say, weak compared to the flows that are released during major events by volcanoes like Krakatoa. And I say that because the speed of it was slower, and the temperature of it was, thankfully, far cooler than the flow that decimated the Roman settlements of Pompeii and Herculaneum, among several others, or the flow that took over 30,000 lives within the span of a single minute when a massive pyroclastic flow was released during the peak of the 1902 eruption of Mount Pelée, which occurred on the Caribbean island of Martinique. So it's astonishing that there were any survivors of this event. Even though the eruption only measured a magnitude 2 on the Volcanic Explosivity Index, the fact that a crew of people survived being stuck on a tiny island during this hazardous event, and that many survived, is astounding. But of course, I'm glad that they did. Many didn't though, and my thoughts of course go out to them and their families. Along with the pyroclastic flow was the genuine and present threat of noxious gases, the inhalation of which could lead to incapacitation and death or other more painful, non-YouTube friendly things that I'm sure you can guess happen to a person's lungs and body when they inhale the type of noxious substances released during a volcanic eruption. And as previously mentioned, volcanic bombs and blocks would have been cascaded out in all directions. The immediate aftermath. 22 people died either in the explosion or from injuries sustained, including two whose bodies were never found and were later declared dead. A further 25 people suffered injuries, most needing intensive care for severe burns. Continuing seismic and volcanic activity along with heavy rainfall, low visibility, and the presence of toxic gases hampered recovery efforts over the week following the incident. And in present day, White Island is still just as active as it's ever been. In summary, the White Island volcanic eruption is a textbook example of how phreatic events prematurely trigger large-scale eruptions. They're responsible for the fracturing of rocks surrounding a magma chamber, and when fractured enough, if water enters and can make direct contact with the body of magma, scary events like this occur. Phreatomagmatic events are responsible for some of the most significant and powerful volcanic eruptions of history. The island of Santorini is one example of a notable phreatomagmatic eruption in history which may be directly responsible for the fall of the Minoan civilization. And I'm not going to say I'm sad, because whenever I played the Minoans in Age of Empires 1, let's just say I did not enjoy only using ships. Now, you all know I love volcanoes, but would I ever set foot on this island? Hell no. Why? Because I know if it goes off, I'm screwed. But would I look at it from a helicopter? Yes. Would I step foot on this place of desolation, brimstone, and hellfire? Yeah, nah, I wouldn't. It could be wiser to conduct helicopter tours from now on, but what do I know? So the next time you go to an active volcano, ask yourself, should I risk my life for a few selfies on an active volcano, or should I just appreciate it from afar? The choice is ultimately yours. This company served as an outlet to allow you to make that choice. No one can predict these events. We can somewhat predict magma rising, but we can't predict phreatic events as of yet. They aren't directly associated with magma. As I mentioned before, they're steam-driven explosions and they're random. There's no way anyone could have predicted when this event was going to occur. Even if a geologist was on site, and even if seismic readings were being measured, it happened in a split second when the hydrothermal seal failed, and no one even knew that a hydrothermal seal was present to begin with. All that we knew is that activity had increased, which is normal for active volcanoes, especially those near subduction events. Normally, they experience fluctuations of activity and inactivity, and it was that interpretation that ultimately led to the occurrence of this tragedy. And perhaps it's best that we leave White Island to do its thing until eventually the system driving it becomes inactive. Thanks for watching.